Man, I wish I could play some music right now. Well, yeah, welcome. This is day 172, Making Songbringer. About 6 months into making this game, got about 6 months left. And yesterday I was working on these frogs. I'm excited to have them. Whoops. Anyways, the frogs now eat the flies. That's really cool. They stick out their tongues and grab some flies whenever a fly comes nearby one of them. And now I've just added Z. How the hell did that happen? Anyways, you can see when I hit some enemies, and when I get hit by enemies as well, the player hops, or the enemy hops a bit. And you can see it's actually using Z acceleration. So it properly applies its Z acceleration. What's up, QLav? Hey, man. What's up, Momir? Yeah, I was just talking about how Z acceleration is now finally being applied, and it's being applied correctly too. So I have a whole velocity system in place, which is not operating in the way that normal acceleration works. This is kind of like a direct way of doing acceleration. Well, hello, Grubuck. Yo. Yeah, so now I've got this proper Z acceleration, which is, whoops. It basically just applies gravity to the current Z acceleration per frame, and then it computes the current Z velocity based on the acceleration times the time. So time gets multiplied in there twice, just like it's supposed to be. And that's how Z acceleration works. So now that I've got that in there, I can do lots of cool stuff. I can make the player jump. I can make little water hopper enemies. I can make frogs jump from one platform to another. So that's what I'm going to do right now. I'm going to make some little water hoppers. So I'm going to start off with creating a profile for the water hoppers. They're going to be similar to the fly. So I'm just duplicating fly. I'm going to call this hopper. I'm thinking I'm going to have some of them be grasshoppers and some of them be water hoppers. Or I might just make them both the same one. I don't know. So I'm going to start off with the hopper.plist. And I'm also going to give it a hopper.text for its behavior. There we go. So now we've got the two data files created for them. And let's get everything about the hopper started here. It's going to have, its sprite is basically just pixel. It's a single pixel. There's one of those. It has the behavior of a hopper. Movement. I'm thinking, that's fly speed. Hopper speed. I don't know. This might be a way even faster than a fly. Has no shadow. Doesn't have a path find. It's bound by the area. Doesn't need to have reflection. Reflections are default. So I can even turn fly's reflection off. And let me verify that. So I should still have the flies should still have a reflection on the water. Yeah. Cool. So they have a tiny little dot for their reflection. Good. Okay, so we can start with the hopper's behavior. It doesn't do this whole slow fast thing like flies do. It doesn't even have a target. All it does is bounce. In fact, it should probably start with something like the blobs AI. Maybe not. Yeah, let's just do this. Durand. Target none. Doesn't matter what the target is. Okay, so let's create a hopper now. Now we've got this, the data part done. Well, not done, but started. We can go where the area creates some, when it creates things like the flies, create some hoppers. There'll be a lot of them in the mangroves, but not that many. Okay, and I want them to be green. Let's grab a green color, which I want it to kind of match the grass, but be a bright part of the grass. So I'm gonna go to, should be called Overworld. All right, so let's make the water hoppers the same color as the very top of the grass, like that. That's 88, 124, 56. Okay. And we're gonna make them partially transparent. 157, I think, is the phi ratio times 255. Let me check that. Should know this one by heart. Yeah, 157, 158. Okay, so there, we've got a, oh, we need to create a hopper, not a fly. All right, there we go. Hopper. So there, I'm making sure the random numbers for them are a little bit different than the flies by adding one to its Y. Yeah, the water hoppers are going to be green. Well, for this, yeah, for this particular whole, this world, whatever, yeah. I guess the water hopper would probably be black, actually, on Earth, but this planet, we're going to have some green water hoppers. For now, maybe we'll change that. Okay, that ought to do it. Let's see what that looks like. Should have a sort of a wandering green dots, a few wandering green dots, and then we'll make them so they jump and stuff. All right, yeah. There's a few of them there. They're wandering around. They're quite quick. Let's turn off their opacity so you can see a little clearly. More clearly. Yeah, all right, I'm gonna make them even brighter. 127, 179, 81. Whoop. Yeah, the next thing is going to be making them hop. Yeah, there we go. Now those are kind of bright. You can see them more clearly. I mean, there's just way too many of them compared to how many flies there are around on the screen and stuff right now. But once they start having a different behavior where they actually hop and stuff, it's going to look right. Okay, so let's do that. Let's do the behavior. This is going to be a new kind of thing. I'm going to make sure. I'm going to start already with adding a behavior word for being able to jump. So this is just the word jump I'm adding to the behavior. So this word can be parsed. There we go. Okay, so we got that word hooked up. Now I need to be able to, you know, I'm gonna write my behavior for the hoppers. So I'm kind of like, it just hops when it every once in a while. So we'll go call this sequence hop. We're comment out this bounce sequence for now. And I'm just gonna go every once in a while, jump. Now the jump is going to have a I'm just gonna give it a strength factor for now and do the rest of the math for that what that turns out to be in the code. So I'm gonna start with this. I know I want this jump command to have multiple different uses. Like I want the frogs to be able to jump from one lily pad to another. So in the case of a frog, this would be something like jump lily pad. And that would mean that in the system for movement, it would go and find a new lily pad to jump to and then apply a jump that perfectly jumped it to that new lily pad. Now, another way to do jumps, I'm thinking, is like these hoppers where we just want to do like jump 20 or whatever, and that's like the distance on the screen if it were on the X plane, how far it would go with its jump. So let's actually put that up to 40, and that will actually be a random jump. So if all you have is a strength factor on the jump, then the system is going to just apply it in a random angle. So let's do that. Okay, I'm gonna go to the AI system where it's running behaviors. And we're gonna add a new behavior type. It's called jump. Okay, so we know if we have one value and it's a float, then we're gonna do a random jump based on strength. Okay, so we're gonna randomly choose an angle, drand f01 times mpi, times 2. All right, yeah, that'll give us an angle. Now, move velocity on the y is already automatically applied. Let's just do this. E dot move dot velocity equals I thought VEC2 had a function for giving you a position based on an angle. Yeah, there's angle, of course. That's not what I was thinking. I want an angle based on Is there not none of those? Whatever, it's just sine, cosine. Yeah, I'm just gonna do this manually. All right, it's okay. Vec two, cosine is gonna be x. No, is that right? I think it is cos. Multiply that times the strength, float val zero. And we'll give it like a hoppy e.move dot z excel. We'll do float val zero times. This is all this math is kind of new, so I'm really not sure what how big these factors should be and all that. So I'm just gonna try. 5. We could do times 4.0 for now. We'll see if that works. Hello, Hazard. Okay, so I'm gonna set a breakpoint here and just see if it even is hitting this jump command. Nice, cool, man. Well, welcome back again, and it's good to be back myself from vacation, making games once again, my favorite thing to do. I love the combination of so many art forms that is called game development. Okay, so we got an angle. What's the angle? 4.9. That sounds like it's less than 2. Pi radians, okay. And then our velocity, let's see what that came out to be. E move velocity. Okay, that seems reasonable. And then Z acceleration. Also looks reasonable. I'm gonna turn off my breakpoint and run it. Ah, cool, it worked. They're totally just hopping all over the place. All right, cool, yay. All right, I want them to hop more, of course. So let's do, let's delete this breakpoint. Let's make the hop bigger. Just increase this number for now. I'm gonna try a whole 100. Man, that is funny to see. They're barely moving on the XY plane. I wonder why that is. Oh, because it's some kind of instantaneous acceleration-y thing. Let's multiply this by 4 as well. All right, so what's going on is it's because I have two different kinds of systems for acceleration, that's why these hoppers are they're getting to the peak of their jump. Yeah, it's a top hat. You can throw it too. I don't think I have the throwing a top hat item right now. But yeah, if I were to throw the top hat, it would. Let me show you what I mean. Okay, so what I was saying there was that basically this needs to be bigger. And decelerate, or maybe just decelerate slower. Yeah, that's probably what it needs, decelerate slower. Yeah, okay, so that was good, 4.0, and we'll decel it slower. Where is that hopper? Oh, no worries. Yeah, I'm gonna show you, man. Sorry, I got distracted here with this one little change. So, yeah, that should decelerate it slower. Once again, this is kind of a janky, it's not janky, but it's two different acceleration systems. The X and Y have one acceleration system, and the Z has another. Yeah, okay, that's better. It should definitely last a little longer, but let me show you the top hat. So yeah, you can throw it. It comes back to you. You can hit enemies with it. You can pick up items with it. In fact, this would be a fun thing to throw and be able to maybe hit the frogs or something. Okay, so that was good. Having these decel slower, but it was a bit too slow. So let's do phi ratio instead of 0.3. So just trying to dial in the right combination here to get that arc to be just right. Yeah, that's pretty good. 'Cause yeah, with the jump of which is awesome. All right, so man, I'm liking hoppers already. Let's go to the hoppers. This and is the jump is still a bit too strong, so let's do jump 61.8. Oh, yeah, it does match his hair. Huh. I did that on purpose when I first drew the character because I wanted it to not distract you from anything. That's pretty great. I like these hoppers already. Cool. You can't catch the hoppers and the flies, but the frogs can. So the frogs will actually eat the flies. Watch this. If I turn on, if I make their 99 flies or something crazy, or maybe no, it's like 999 flies. This is gonna be a ton of flies. But if I put a ton of flies on the screen, you'll see the fly or the frogs start to eat them. Oh, Zong, yeah, what's up, man? When you throw your hat and you go off to a different screen, you just get it back anyways. Yeah, so you just recover your hat. You know, it's a video game. You kind of gotta like make some choices like that eventually. Some things you don't just ex ever explain. So there, you see the frogs? They're like sticking out their tongue, and they're actually catching and eating the flies. So give this enough time, and they will actually eat every single fly that's on the screen. Actually, so I'm pretty sure these water hoppers are basically done, except that I want them to cause a ripple now. So this is gonna be a fun part right here. I'm gonna make a new shader that's going to do ripples, and so this new ripple shader will happen. It'll launch a new ripple for each time the water hopper lands on the water. So I don't know if you can tell, but yeah, there's already a lot less flies on the screen. If I were to go to a different screen, though, you would have, once again, 999 flies. So, yeah, that just shows you, basically. Yep. Oh, right. Yeah. I do plan to have something like that in this game. I just haven't decided what it will be yet. I love the concept of bottles or those glasses in Zelda. Well, that's like one of my favorite items to get, right? It's just such a rewarding thing to be able to get a bottle because you're like, whoa, I could put anything in this. And I love that feeling, that openness, and that sense of reward. So I'd like to have some kind of item like that in this game. I'm just not sure what it's going to be yet. Okay, so let's make the water hoppers a little bit transparent. And let's start the shader. For now, I'm going to duplicate the... Catching fairies is awesome. Cube waves. This is kind of like similar to what I'm thinking for ripples. So I'm going to duplicate the cube waves shader. Wait a minute. This might be a reflection shader that I'm actually thinking of. Yeah, I'm pretty sure I do want to put this in to the reflection shader. Wait a minute, the reflection shader. I'm trying to think of whether I should put it on the reflection. Each sprite for the reflection shader, or whether I should put it on the whole reflection shader. Let me see where I'm actually using reflection, the reflection shader. Here's where I cache it. Here it is. Oh no, here it is. Sprite reflection. Yeah, okay, so a sprite reflection is a custom sprite. So that means for every reflection sprite, let's check that out in the component for reflection component. There it is. Yeah, we use sprite reflection. Okay, so I'm just kind of remembering how the heck reflections work so that I can do a ripple. So yeah, it can't just be based on the reflection component's reflection sprite. It has to be based on some other stuff. A fool's duty. I'm just using C++ 11. And yeah, that was GLSL you're seeing right there. Am I cute? You mean code? You get auto-corrected there? Okay, alright. Let's go. Right, code. Cool, that's what I thought. Alright, So yeah, this needs to be an effect that runs on the entire screen, not just a single sprite, because we want water to ripple even in areas where there is no reflection sprite. So yeah, I'm going to start with, this is like the cube waves. All that. But yeah, ripples. Here we go, ripples. Ripple shader. All right, we can go and where we're loading the shaders, we can go and cache another shader called ripples. All right. Now we need to do a new kind of lens effect. Ripple. This thing has a position. Doesn't have a parent. Has a duration and a position. Okay, so the next part here is to set up the code for running a ripple lens effect. What did I do? What? Expected member name? What am I doing wrong here? What? Yeah, I would say that GLSL is a difficult thing. At least it was for me. I guess it really depends on who you are as a programmer. But yeah, I've got some great places you should check out. Check out Shaderific for their intro to GLSL. And also they have an amazing... like built-in functions. They show you all the built-in stuff about GLSL. This has helped me immensely. Shaderific. And then also check out Shader Toy. This is a really great one for getting inspired. It shows you like all these different new shaders that people have developed. Look at that. That's an actual shader. It's incredible. And then you, when all of these different shaders, you can click on them and actually see the code for them in GLSL. So that's just really, really valuable. Grubuck. No, I don't want to be calling cube waves. Oh, is that what it is? Oh, thank you. Thank you. I was like, what the heck is going on here? It's one of those days. Can't see what's right in front of my face. Okay, so yeah, we got ripples. Now we got to hook up an actual effect for these ripples in the code. So this is going to be similar, once again, to the cube waves animation. And all these are really doing is applying some effects to the render texture. Hey Teek, what's up, man? And then showing the render texture to be visible. Yeah, cool. Yeah, check those out. Those are great ways to learn GLSL. The tricky part about GLSL is that you don't. It's hard to debug, you know what I mean? It's like, it's hard to know what variables mean what and what does what, because you can't just set a breakpoint inside of a shader unless, you know, there's good tools out there for actually debugging shaders and stuff, but I haven't found any. I've been looking, but I haven't really found any good tools for that kind of stuff, so If anybody has good tips about how to debug GLSL, let me know and I can share with other people. All right, so we've got to set up the ripples shader. We don't need anything to do with this render. We just want to set all the variables. So see, we've already got a position. Let's just call that P. There. So we're passing in a few different variables here, setting additive, stuff like that. This is going to basically run the exact same thing as the cube waves shader, but it's going to do it at a ripple position. So let's set it now. So we actually need to do some other words here. So we need a word for the behavior to be able to do a lens effect. All right, I mean, yeah, that's really the right way to do this. No, wait, no, never mind. Yeah, I guess we can hook up this word, but still, this is probably not how I'm gonna implement this. I want it to do the lens effect when the water hopper lands, and that is not easy to do inside a behavior. The benefit of using auto is that you don't have to know the type. And it's especially awesome for things that are very long. Like, so, say you had a vector. No, let's say you had a const vector. Const vector int something. And then you wanted to iterate over that vector. So you'd want to go const vector int iterator it equals something dot begin. See where I'm going with this? Look how long this took me to just do that. That's wrong, isn't it? No viable conversion from const. Anyways, do you get the point? This is the point. It's like way shorter. So for example, I could just go auto it equals something dot begin. See how much like easier that is to do? Oh, this, I think that might need to be const auto. I don't know. I hope you get the point there. Oh, that's nice. Nice. So you self wrote your own precompiler for GLSL and you can debug it. That's really cool. All right, Thomas, thanks, man. Thanks for saying hi. Uh-huh, cool. Well, I hope that works for you guys. For now, now that I kind of know GLSL, I don't really need to worry so much about debugging it. Okay, so yeah, I want the water hopper to... do a landing ripple if he lands on water. Okay, I'm going to start by hacking this into a place in the code where I know it's landing. So yeah, this is just going to be a total hack at first. This is where I know that the Z lands. Now, okay, so here's where the hack begins. Profile.profile.getTitle equals hopper. We're going to launch one of these new effects. So lens push effect new ripples. No, new lens ripples. I believe that was duration. Let's give it a long duration at first. And then the position, which is e dot position dot pause 2 vec2 times kit pixel. Okay, that ought to do it. Just to start testing it out. Grubuck, yes, it does. You have successfully seen into the pros and cons of using auto. Good job, man. Yes, it's true. A lot of times it can be better to use auto. And you're not when you're not sacrificing as much readability, but there are certain cases where it's much better to not use auto. And you see me do that, especially like when I like right here, I'm using float instead of auto because I want to convert this integer type right here into a float. I want to know that this is a float. So I don't always use auto, but there are cases, or there's a lot of cases actually where it's way shorter and way faster to code with using auto. It's a very handy thing. Nice. Yeah, I could definitely check that out. I don't know how much I would use it or not. I really don't use shaders that often to where a whole environment like that would help that much, but I don't know. It definitely would be a cool open sourced kind of tool. Yeah, Screwbuck, yeah. I see what you're saying there. Okay, let's try this out. Should be set up to do some kind of lens effect whenever a hopper lands. We're gonna get multiple of them going on. Let's only do one hopper to start with. Cool. Okay, we don't need 999 flies either. Oh yeah, it's working. Let's turn off these. These should be more like I think they were 21. Wow. Okay, cool, it's working. So the hopper is jumping around on the screen, and everywhere he lands, it's doing a cube wave-like effect, which is like the effect for the teleport cube. Okay. I know, right? A fool's duty. I'm working on water hoppers right now. The next thing I'm doing is making them so they do a water ripple when they land. So this is cool. I'm gonna check this out later on. This might be what I was looking for as far as like something to debug GLSL. Awesome. Thank you, Teek. All right, so the next thing is to make it so that he only does the water ripple thing when he lands on water. So we want to go the current area. We've already got that. That's great. Area dot get tile for the current position for, yeah, let's do a position. So we're going to get the tile at the current position. Actually, we'll do it is tile. There's a rough check to see if. Why is that not compiling? Is tile really? Is private? Let's make that public. There. Yeah, that's a good point too. It totally depends on your team, right? And your overall context of your development really plays a big role in whether you're going to use auto or not. Why do we have an error? We already have a P variable. Right, let's see why that. Oh yeah, XY. There. Okay. So that should make it so it's testing the area to see where the water hopper lands. If it lands on some dirt or anything other than water, it shouldn't do the ripple. If it lands only if it lands on water, will it do the ripples. And then we'll start working on the effect so it looks more like a ripple instead of this cube wavy effect thing. He's stuck. It looks like he's stuck. Oh no, it hopped. Okay, it hopped off the screen, hopped back on. It's just stuck up there in the top. Hey, what's up, Proton? It's going great, man. Working on lots of fun things that have nothing to do with gameplay, at least yet. Okay, so let's make the water hopper hop a little more happily. We could start by making him so he doesn't hop as far. Or maybe no, let's make him so he hops a lot more often. So we can get the just feeling for, you know, if it's working where if he lands on some ground. Yeah, see there. Yeah. Look, he's hopping on the ground and he's not doing any ripples. Wait a minute. Now he's hopping on water and he's still not doing any ripples. It's crazy seeing such an excited water hopper. Huh. All right. Okay, that's cool seeing it do a lot, do that that often. So the next thing is to do is to make it so the ripples look cool. The ripples look like actual water ripples. So yeah, I'm gonna take a quick break and I'll come back to it and do that. So I'll leave the game running for a second. Cool. That was kind of neat. I came back to my computer after it ran for a while and it was not overheating. Okay. Yeah, so I'm wondering if these ripples will actually look cool being rendered at this full resolution. Let's see. See what we can come up with. This shader. Ripples. Let's make that, turning that off will make it so it's not circular, it's more oval shaped. All right, so the center is the center of the ripple. Vtex coordinate is the current fragment coordinate we're working on inside this shader. That's the current pixel, basically. This is the center of the ripple. This is, so distance is the length from the center of the ripple to the current pixel. So if that's less than the radius.x, then we're gonna do the effect. The X wave is a sine wave. Based on time and the distance and the length of the X. Man. Yo, what's up, Brad? Howdy, man. Howdy do, dude. How's things going, man? How's soccer? I'm sitting here trying to figure out a new kind of shader for doing ripples. I'm open to suggestions. My brain is not exactly in the zone yet for complex math. Trigonometry. I guess I should start all this over. So this is all the math for the cube wave, and I should do something totally different. Yeah, ripples on the water. So check it out. I've got some flies. I got some, the frogs eat the flies. That's cool. So if a fly gets near a frog, it'll get eaten. But that little green dot you see hopping around, when it lands on the water, it does that effect, which is like it's a lot like the effect for the teleport cube. So I wanted to just basically do ripples instead of this effect. So I should probably start over with something and just do sine. Yeah, in fact, I'm going to do that. I'm going to start over. I'm gonna delete everything I'm not using here. I'm rendering on top of a render texture, it's kind of like a normal map, but all I really want to accomplish are ripples. So I'm really just doing, first thing I'm gonna do waves coming out from the center of this point. So I think I'm just going to start over with this whole algorithm. That should do it. That should do nothing, right? If I got Yeah. Okay, so if I set the color to be totally white, all right, I'm gonna make him so he also doesn't jump to the left or the right. I just want him to jump straight up and down so he stays on the water the whole time. So I'm gonna go to the AI system for when it runs a behavior, go to where it does the ripple or where it does the jump. And not apply any velocity for a second. So that should keep him in the same place so he can keep on doing the same effect over and over and over. Okay, yeah. All right, cool. We've got a white wavy sort of thing going on. That's cool. Right, back to ripples. So, why was that doing time? Yeah, Momir, good night, man. Later. I think it's in the way the overall lens effect. Does it? Yeah, the radius is multiplied by alpha right here. Okay. So yeah, that's why. Okay, I don't want radius to be multiplied by alpha in this case. Cuz I want the radius of the each ripple to be its own thing, but it to always have a maximum radius. Yeah, okay. Now we have a constant radius there. Hi, Ethan. What's up, man? Okay. So now I can start applying time to this radius. I just want. Going to start with one single circle. Oval, one single oval expanding out. That's really all I want. Single oval expands out over time on both X and Y. Nice, man. Actually, it's going to be very similar to this X wave. We got. Want to multiply this by 2 pi. Let's just do X wave. All right. It's still not a ripple yet, but at least it's something to start. Nice. Cool. Good for you. Making you learn Unity. Awesome. So if we take away y from this equation, simplify this. I think it might need to be 1 minus x. Yeah, okay, yeah. There now we're getting. We still need to be actually v dot x plus v dot y. Would that make it a circle? Oh, that makes it a diamond. Guess let's stick to this for now. I think it's supposed to be 1 minus v dot x. I want to get him to be jumping more consistently too. That's what he was originally. Let's do an alternate sequence for hopping. Yeah, I should make him jump every 2 seconds. I'm making water ripples right now. Damn it. Jump, man, jump. There. So I didn't like this other sequence. Being first. Okay. Okay, yeah. So the first thing I want to do is make it so they move these ripples. Well, they're not even ripples yet, but I want them to move outwards rather than inwards. So. Maybe it's supposed to be 1 minus time. Nope. I wonder what the heck time is actually. Yeah, I want it to ripple outwards. That's exactly what I'm trying to do right now, is just get it to go outwards first. The wave. I'm wondering what time is. It might be 0 to 1. What's up, Felix? Okay, so here's the loop duration. Yeah, it's 0 to 1. So it starts at 0, it goes to 1 when it's at full time. And then if it goes beyond the loop duration, yeah, it's gonna loop over. So it's 0 to 1, and then it instantly goes back to 0. 0 to 1, 0 to 1, 0 to 1. Okay, so that should be enough to know the sine graph starts at 0 and it goes to its max. I believe that should just be 2 or 1 pi. All right, cool. That was it. Just had to go pi instead of 2 pi. Man, I'm fumbling today. This is what happens. Oh, wait, that moves outwards too? What the heck? Maybe it's because I uncommented that. Yeah. Think that shouldn't have anything to do with X. Just be time. Interesting. Okay, yeah, that's what sine of time would just be. Let's do a Y wave as well. See if we can get this to actually be an oval. Whoa. So funny, right? Yeah, the ripple center is center. That's what this uniform is. That's the center of the ripple point. So, yeah, that didn't work at all to try and do a Y wave and an X wave. This is typically how I try and do math in shaders. I just fumble around until I finally get it working. It takes me hours, and I'll probably spend the rest of the day just doing this, but eventually I'll get it and I'll have some cool looking ripples. Right, so the wave already always starts the wrong point in the time. Yeah, that was cool, right? The interference pattern. Wasn't quite what it wasn't a ripple, but it was kind of cool. Infinite loop, what's up, man? Yeah, I had a great break. It's really great to come back to everything with the totally fresh eyes and see little things I never saw before. It's really great for habits too, just break out of your old habits and start some new habits when you get home. So time goes from 0 to 1. I know that. V dot x v dot x is going to be 0 at the center, and v dot x is going to be 1 at the edge. No, I haven't got enough pre-orders really to make much of a difference. That's a good question. Yeah, I was kind of when the Kickstarter was rocking and rolling and stuff, I was kind of had this expectation that, yeah, I'm going to get tons of pre-orders. But really, Kickstarter itself is a great way to develop attention for the game. And so it's the Kickstarter did so well, but like just trying to get my own pre-orders just from people, you know, browsing through my site. It's the fact is my website, songbringer.com, doesn't get as much traffic as Kickstarter does. And it's not as much of an event either, so people aren't going to, you know, all the people I tell about the Kickstarter, they would go and check it out and things like that. But pre-orders, yeah, they just haven't been a very good way to make money, but or make enough money to actually get it on Android and PlayStation 4 and all that. But what's cool is the guys from RetroVGS are interested in the game. So if you haven't seen Brad, you should check this system out. It's pretty cool. RetroVGS is a new school console system for playing retro games, but it's new games. So you have to write, you know, it's on cartridges too. So basically it's a new school. It's a system for playing new retro games, and all the games you play are, they're on cartridges and they're never updated. So like basically, check it out, Super Noah's Ark. But yeah, Songbringer is going to be one of the games basically that's on the system. So these cartridges, they're never updated either. So like you buy one of these cartridges, the whole point of this system is longevity. So their goal for this is for these cartridges and this system to last for decades. You know what I mean? So you buy, and you're only ever going to buy one Retro VGS system. Like, it's never going to be a PlayStation type thing. Like, there's PlayStation 2, 3, 4, 5. There's only going to be one Retro VGS, and it never updates itself. Yeah, I'm definitely going to need some help testing this for sure when it comes to this point. But what's cool is Retro VGS is actually, you just actually hook up your Retro VGS system to your computer with USB. And that's how you debug the game. So that's, you don't need to buy an expensive dev kit or anything like that. So yeah. So I'm doing a really horrible job of explaining this system right now. But yeah, it's worth checking out. But that's going to be after the Steam version. So the Steam version is still coming out January, February, March. That's the goal. And then I'll have 6 more months after that. So basically, RetroVGS is launching their Kickstarter in the next like 2 months or so, 3 months, something like that. And they are, when you order a RetroVGS, you get to choose a bunch, maybe like 2 or 3 games that get to come with your system. And that's part of your Kickstarter pledge or whatever. So one of your rewards. So one of the games you'll be able to choose from that is Songbringer. So you'll be able to actually choose that. So I might technically get some pre-orders that way. So in answer to your question, yeah, pre-orders have not been that effective for me to develop enough income to do more platforms, but RetroVGS has come out of it, so that's pretty cool. Yeah, I know, Fools, dude, that's a good point, right? But I love the old school days when you released games and the game that you released was the final product. So if there's bugs, Those are features now, you know what I mean? That's the kind of game I want to strive to write, is a game that's that quality. It's been tested that much that it's never going to be updated again. That's when I grew up writing games, that's how it had to be. You had to make games right the first time. There was no updating whatsoever. And I miss those days. I wish game developers still developed games that were that high quality. Today, a game developer can go and release a game that doesn't even work. You can go buy a $60 game today that doesn't even work the second you get it home. Right, or there's downloadable content, right? Yeah, things like that. So I miss those days. I totally miss the days where we had static games that never updated themselves. And the guys at RetroVGS they kind of have that concept too, and I like, well, I like where they're going with it. Yes, exactly. So, man, my brain is just like not quite in the zone to be doing shaders right now. I just want that wave to start from the center, and I want it to be a ripple. So I guess that, let's see, what if we did y wave is a cosine? All right, once again, we've got this weird interference pattern going. I think these are supposed to both be sine. I think what I'm trying to do here is C equals VEC4 of length. Of VEC2, X wave, Y wave. Hope that's what I'm thinking. Yes, I did learn C before C++. Yeah. I recommend doing it that way. Anybody that's wants to learn C++, start with C. Whoa, that's weird. Now we got like a honeycomb type. It's the exact opposite of that interference. I'm just stumbling. I can do this. I can make a single ripple. All I want to do is a single ripple, an oval that expands outward. Know, right? Especially when when your brain's not in the zone for math. So we've got an oval. It's the edge of the oval. The oval expands. All I want to do is say it's the radius. It's the radius of the oval or a circle. It's like essentially this is a circle. It will naturally become an oval. So the edge. Oh, I think it's actually this. It's think it's the length of the vector. A gradient circle? Yeah, exactly. The distance to the center, the radius, right? That's what I think this is, length V. Nope. Oh, length V, but times time. Maybe. No. Oh, man. Yeah, modulated with time. Right? Yeah, right. We're on the same page. I'm having trouble trying to put this into actual math right now. I'm pretty sure V is accurate. It should be a 0 to 1 length vector. In fact, I can check that by just looking at V dot x times time, I guess. Right? Oh man. Oh, okay. Wait. So the radius of the oval is time. So as time expands, right, that's going to increase the radius of this circle. So time times radius. Yeah, I don't know if that's going to do it either. Could try it though. You did length plus time? Try that. Yeah, that's not it either. Okay, yeah, so I think radius equals time. Basically, this is the equation. Yeah, this really is time times radius. Did I have the one in the VEC4? Oh, yeah. Sorry. Let's see what that does. That is kind of it, right? If we did 1 minus, or maybe it's 1 over. This is close though, man. You almost. It is. It's so much closer. Thank you, Orphis Flow. You're supposed to do 1 minus time. Oh, that makes it go inwards. What if you do 1 minus the length? I'm your excuse for not packing, all right. Dang. 5 hours? Well, I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing to be such a distraction. I guess I'm sorry and I'm happy for you at the same time. I hope you're getting some enjoyment out of this or something. Man, how long have I been streaming? This is probably the slowest I've ever gone trying to make a shader before. Don't pack. Don't do it, man. Yes. Take your whole house with you. Yes. We're gonna unite tomorrow. Oh, that's good. It is a bad thing. That's cool. You're only moving 100 meters. That's really great. What do you even have to pack for? I guess that is a whole football field, huh? Is it you have to go upstairs, downstairs? Let's do some faster ripples. These are like anti-ripples. They're not even ripples yet. Right? So if that was an actual ripple and it looked like a ripple, that would be kind of what I would want to do is like make it go really fast like that. Let's take the size down a bit, the radius, take it down to like, don't know, 45. And put that loop duration slower. It's weird, it's only doing it for a second, and it should be doing it over the whole second. Ah, cool. Wondering why I'm doing this for a duration of 1 second. It should only loop once, but I see that at the very end it's starting to loop again. Oh no. It's just that it starts big. Okay, yeah. That is one exact second, one exact loop. It's just that it starts like halfway through it somehow. Okay, well. Typically, the strategy I use when I'm not in the zone, the right zone to do a certain task, is I'd like to switch tasks, do something else. So right now, I can't figure shaders out for the life of me. So I'm going to switch gears here and do the other thing I wanted to do today, and that is to make the frogs jump. So the frogs, I want them to jump. Like they're gonna have a sequence every once in a while. They're gonna jump to a new lily pad. So I'm gonna do like if ran like every 10 seconds, We're going to do a jump to a new lily pad. Now, the 1 over V was just to get it from 0 to 1. Yeah, that's a good question. But see this, V is the vector from the center. These are in screen coordinates, right? So that's why they have to be divided by the radius and to become a length vector from 0 to 1. And the 1 minus just simply makes it go from, instead of being from 1 to 0, it goes from 0 to 1. So I know this is correct, this part right here. This is just giving me a 0 to 1 length vector. And yes, it is causing that effect, but it is the right effect that's supposed to be happening. I just need to use this number properly. So basically what's happening is it's the V is the distance from the center of the ripple to the current pixel. So that's all I got right now. Yeah, cool. Yeah, so yeah, I'm gonna do a different task. Allow my brain to think about this whole shader for a minute, and I'll come back to this like 2 hours later, and it'll be all easy. I'll be like, oh, duh. It's the sine of this, and I'll suddenly remember trigonometry, and everything will be easy. So there's no sense beating your head against the wall, especially in game development. I could sit here all day beating my head against the wall. I'm not gonna get anywhere. But if I allow my subconscious mind the time to relax, I allow my conscious mind the time to relax and do something else as well. That's when it always flows. It's a constant lesson I've learned in game development over and over and over. So I'm gonna honor that lesson and just switch to something else. So I got this set up now, so the frogs should have a pattern where they can jump, but they're not going to because they don't have a factor yet for their jumps. Cool, so let's get the system going when an AI does a jump. So num values equals 1 and stir val 0 dot size is greater than 0. This is going to be a random jump to named location. So we're going to loop over all the name components for lily pads and stuff like that. So the first thing I want to do is make the area when it creates lily pads. It needs to give the each lily pad a name component so that when the frogs are looking for a new place to jump, they can go, oh, which lily pad should I jump onto? So lily pad is just going to be the name of it. We go. Now I'm going to create a new function inside of name component or name system. I forget which. This works. We'll just do this. Get EIDs for a certain name. We're filling up a vector of EIDs. And when we do that, it's in name component. Come on, autocomplete. So lazy. I don't want to type too much because I'm too lazy. So we're looping over all entities that have a name component. And if any get name component So let's do this. E's.clear if name.size less than or equal to 0 return. So we're just like, you know, doing the laying down the foundation for this. And then also if name component.name What the heck? Why isn't it auto-completing? There. Jeez, come on. There. Name component, EID. There, dot name equals name. This is an EID that matches that name, so we're gonna push that back. So EIDs dot push back. There. All right, cool. Now, when we're doing this jump command, got this list of positions, system, let's grab all the entity IDs that will match that. So choose one at random. Why isn't it like that? Oh, this needs to be cast to an EID. There we go. Okay, now we can grab the current that entity. So system. There, that should just warp the frog to a new position. So then we'll work on making it so he actually jumps to that new position. Cool, all right, good. We're getting to this this breakpoint. That means that we're able to process that right the behavior based on the lily pad, and it's parsing it into the right part of the code here. Now we've got strval 0. That should be lily pad. Yeah, cool. We're looking for lily pads. Now if I run name component find, no, that's totally wrong. Totally wrong. This is supposed to be name component. Get EID, get ids. Okay, let's try that again. Now it should find all the positions of every lily pad, choose one at random, warp the frog there instantly. Thanks for following, by the way. Okay, let's see what's up. We ran getIDs. Possible. Yeah, cool. Look at this. We've got all these possible lily pads. Let's see what happens when we get one of them at random. We grabbed 580, which was right in there in the middle of all those, or the third element. Okay, and let's see what happens when we grab that entity dest. It should not have a position component. Yep, position 0. That's cool. But it will have a position based on its sprite. That's why we're grabbing it. So we'll see what happens when I just set the position for the entity to that. This appears to be working. So let's see what happens. That worked. All right, let's try that again. Start over. No breakpoints this time, so system's not just going to run, and then catch up. Yeah, it's working. We can verify this is working by only doing one frog, so I'm going to set the number of frogs back to 1. And so we should just, that way we'll be able to watch one frog move around, and then we can verify that it's working visually. And then we can make it so he actually jumps. There you go, he warped. Where'd he go to though? I don't see him. I don't know how that. Where'd he go? He might have disappeared completely. Okay, let's log out the position that he jumps to. Okay, so I'm going to open up my console and just pay attention to where the frog jumps to. Figure out what the heck, why he just warped to nowhere that one time. There, he did it again. He jumped to 330.24, so he's on the bottom of the screen, and he hasn't warped since. Yes, yeah, exactly, right. Thank you, Orphis. Yes, I totally agree. Oh, there, now he's jumping. Oh, he was there. He was totally there. He just jumped in the bottom corner for a second. Okay, let's make him so he jumps a lot more often. So, like, every a chance in every 2 seconds. Every 2 seconds or so, he'll do a jump. There, he's jumped that one. Keep jumping, man. Where are you? Oh. Oh, he's over there to the right. Okay, I just gotta make him actually jump over time. That'll make this a lot more. So to make him jump, we just need to do a velocity and a Z acceleration. Okay, we got a destination. Let's turn that into a vector. Now we can apply that. So e.move.velocity equals something like v times something else. Let's say 10 to start with. And then e.move.zxl. I have no idea, but let's try 100. There. So instead of just fully warping them to a different place, he's actually gonna hop. He's not gonna hop the exact right distance, but let's see what happens. There we go. Yeah, he hopped that time. Cool. You know what? I'm gonna go do an animation for him. So, open up the frog. We'll save this as frog jump. And it's gonna be a single frame animation. He's just up in the air, flying. Looks too much like a snake. Right? It looks so bad for so many reasons. I wish I had my freaking tablet working. Is so Atari, right? Okay, I need some inspiration. I need to see a frog in mid jump. They're a lot thinner than I remembered. Oh, nice. I missed that jumping link at the top. Okay, so yeah, let's draw something similar. Oh, this is so unnatural feeling trying to draw with my mouse. Right. Thanks, Hazard. Horrible as that does look, think that might be approximately what I'm gonna go with. All right, let's get the instant in the game and see how it looks. This is like one of the worst sprites I've ever made. All right, common. Here we go. Frog jump, zero. Hook up a single frame animation jump. Now, when the frog behavior does its froggy jump, call animate jump. What kind of game is this? It's like Zelda. You'll see. Cool, man. I gotta try this out later. Thanks, Grubuck. Okay, so let's see if that works to make the frog just do his jump animation when he jumps. Come on, buddy, jump. Oh, you crashed. What'd you crash for? Unrecognized behavior type animate? What? Oh, cool. Nice. Yeah, Kogo Studio X does work a little bit different, but essentially the same kind of thing. Animate is the wrong word. Hello, Nerdfall. What's up? What? Okay, frog. Animate croak. Yeah, this is. Oh, the word jump is not okay. The word jump, I think, was the problem. It parsed the word jump. So I'll go to frog and call this one jumping instead. Yeah, I'm good, man. I'm having a slow day. I'm actually, my brain is like at 2% of its power right now or something. Just horrible. Did you see that? Oh, he jumped so far. Oh my gosh, that's great. Okay, let's give him some more j Y jumping or Z jumping power. Let's make it so he faces the right direction when he jumps. So E render dot sprite dot set flipped X to be if destination dot X is greater than or less than 0. What's up, baby? Hey, I'm streaming. Yeah. Okay. In the foil or what? All right. Okay, we'll see you soon. One sec. Thanks, Xbox Toggle Thing. What's up, Hyrule Spy? How you doing, man? Okay, that should make him so he actually faces the right direction when he jumps, and he should have a much higher Z acceleration, so he should jump higher. Let's see what happens. There he goes. He faced the wrong direction that time. He's like never ever facing to the left. That's kind of weird. Nerdfall, this is being developed for Windows, Mac, and Linux primarily. It's going to be released on Steam in about 6 months. And then it's also going to come out on Retro VGS and iOS And if I can get enough funds, it's going to come out on Android, PlayStation 4, and Xbox One as well. So right now you're seeing me develop the Steam version. And I primarily test it on Mac, but I also have the Windows build working, and the Linux build is also quite doable because I'm using Cocos 2DX. All right, so yeah, so the frog's jumping, that's cool. It's good to see him actually animate sort of a jump look. And then, but I'm really wondering why the. Why he's never flipping. Oh, I know, because the render system has this bit which automatically sets its basically I think if I could turn on or if I turn off this one thing it might work. So render dot flags or equals k render no flip x. Yeah, you should be able to. This is a very efficient game so far. It's 2D and all of the shaders I'm doing are single pass. Yeah, it is that. Destination is. Oh no, you're right. You're totally right. That should have been V. Once again, Orphis, thank you, man. Yeah, so that should definitely be V compared. So I might not need this line right here. Let's see if that works. Man, it shows you how dull my brain is today. It's like I just need a rest or something. I probably just need to take the day off or something. Yeah, they did it. Cool. It's super funny when he tries to jump too far. So the next thing to do would be to go into this list and make sure that he only jumps to a lily pad that's close. That's right. Orphis, congrats, man. You're the MVP. What's the most valuable You're the MVC. Most valuable viewer? That might be it. Yes. This is a new award. It's a new award. You're the MVV. Bam! How does it feel? Yes, I agree. I agree. The MVV. So yeah, the thing we're to do here is to go and go through each one of these in the possible array and erase anything that's too far away. So if auto it equals possible dot begin, it's less than possible dot end. Don't increase the iterator. We're gonna test the distance first. Right? That's right. You did, Grubuck. You're the MVV too. You're both MVBs. Don't like this award anymore. You're both VVs. There is no MVV. There's only VVs. It's 4:30 where you're at? Dang, man. Dang, you're going for the long haul tonight, right? All right, so yeah, we're gonna go if the distance from this point. So yeah, we need this point. Hey, thanks for following. So V is going to be entity get render component. There you go. There you go. Yeah. Once the VVs have been established, we can have an MVV battle off. You guys have to do what? Mud wrestling? Leg wrestling? You know, we got to get something really, really fun going on here. Xbox Taco, I stand because it's better for my spine. Nice, nice, man. Two boxes of work done. Okay, so there we go. Entity get render component dot sprite. Well, this is in direction of it. Dot sprite dot get position pixel. Wait, can we do just distance? Distance equals, what's my position? Yeah, we could do distance straight up there. So there. That's what we need to do. We need to calculate the distance from that point to the player, or the frog. Oh, cool, man. Well, it's you know, it sucks to be tired or whatever, but at least you're learning something cool. Blender, Unity. Jello wrestling? There we go. Yeah, game jamming is probably the better choice of it all, but I like Jello wrestling. Live jamming, there you go. All right, so if the distance is greater than something too big, like max dist, let's do that. Const float max distance squared equals 100. No, do powf. Like, the maximum distance is like 50 pixels away, right? So the frog isn't going to leap across the whole screen. So if the distance is greater, oh, let's do squared. Distance squared equals mypaws.distance squared. If distance squared is greater than max distance squared, then it equals possible.erase it. Otherwise, we can increase the iterator. There, now, so after we ran all that, we'll have a list of vectors that are, or a list of eids that are close, or they should be close. Hey, thanks, Nerdfall. Thank you, thank you, thank you. There you go. I think there are a few of those, right? Isn't there just a game dev Reddit or subreddit? Is that one too not newbie? It might be, might not be noob friendly, who knows? All right, frog. Yeah, there you go. Frog, jump, 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 buddy, jump. Keep jumping. Let's get multiple frogs on the screen now. Yeah, game dev. Nice. Thank you. also, we can't jump to... Thanks for following. We can't jump the frog to the same distance. So, like... If distance squared is zero... Let's do a minimum distance. So that has to be a certain distance away. Like 5 pixels is too close. So disk squared is less than min disk squared. Also ignore that. And then after we've done all this, we need to make sure that there is something that we could possibly jump to. So possible.size, then we do all this jumping. Are you talking about the American education system, the European, and are you talking about high school? Are you talking about college? Yeah, cool. All right. Way to go, hopping around, frog. I don't know why he's hopping onto some water, though. He should be hopping right to the center of the lily pad each time. Oh, because the hop isn't quite the right, exactly the right distance. See if we can get a little more height out of this jump and then maybe a little more distance. See what happens then. Dest minus pause. That's not even normalized. So V could be too far actually. Yeah, that's way too far. Okay, let's undo. So, man, to get the frog to actually jump the exact right distance is a matter of calculus. I actually have to do the derivative, like over time, to figure out how much acceleration would be necessary to cause exactly the right jump. This has been a real challenging math day for me. We have no frogs on this screen. Here we go, we got some frogs here. They're just jumping around. You know what? This is a pretty good start. I think I'm gonna call this good for now. The game's looking good. The game has Z. Now, finally, when an enemy or the player is knocked back, there's a Z acceleration that goes on. Every entity can jump. Heck, by tomorrow, I'm having all this code sorted out so that, you know, frogs will jump accurately. I'll probably change it so it's using vector threes for positions, so it simplifies the math a little bit. Basically, I'm happy with how this code is turning out, and I just have to fix a few more things. All I really want to do tonight is make it so the frogs jump accurately from lily pad to lily pad. And then this weird white thing you see going on should turn into a ripple. All I want that to be is an oval expanding outward so the water hoppers can land on the water and do ripples. So two pretty attainable goals that I should be able to fix by tonight. So this is some pretty good progress, and I'm excited about that. And that's it for today's stream. I'm just gonna call it good there. M? Oh, in Xcode? That's because it's showing me that the file's been modified. Yeah, so like these files right here, I've edited game, I've edited component.h, I've edited component.cpp, I've edited all these things in this current session, and it's showing it's modified because I'm in Git, so I can do Git status, and I can show what files have changed. I can go Git diff to do a difference of everything that's changed. So that's what the M means. So yeah, back to your boxes. Sorry, man. Sorry, I'm closing down the stream. Yes, I saved a link to your pastebin, so that ought to be good. I'll check that out later. So yeah, everybody enjoy your day. And I'll catch you tomorrow. I'll be back same time. I'm usually about 4 p.m. Pacific time that I start my live stream. And yeah, I'm excited to show you how I finish up these jumps for the frogs and the ripples. And once again, the game you saw me developing here is called Songbringer. And it's coming out in about 6 months, January-ish, for Steam. And then it eventually comes out for iOS and Android. It's a Zelda-like game. There's levels, there's dungeons, there's overworlds, and it's procedurally generated. So every world, there's actually 308 million possible worlds in this game. So, yeah, I'm just working on artistic things this week, like the frogs and flies and butterflies and water hoppers and things like that have no effect on gameplay. So, once again, thanks to you guys, and I'll see you next time.